In another video, I talked about the cells of the nervous system. It's always fascinating to me that so much of the functioning of the nervous system is conducted on the cellular and chemical scale. The purpose of this video is to focus on that chemical level. Chemical messengers are chemicals released by your body that elicit some sort of response. There are two main types of chemical messengers in your body: neurotransmitters and hormones. Hormones are chemicals released by your endocrine system glands located throughout your body. This includes structures like your pituitary, thyroid, adrenal glands, and sex-specific organs like ovaries and testicles, among many others. The main difference between hormones and neurotransmitters is that hormones are released into your bloodstream, and neurotransmitters are released within your nervous system between neurons. Hormones generally aren't as quick as neurotransmitters, but their effect lasts longer. Neurotransmitters generally are much quicker, but don't last as long. In another video, I mentioned how neurons function in your nervous system. If you haven't watched that video on the nervous system cells, I suggest you check it out before watching the rest of this video. You can find the link for it below. In that video, I talked about how electrical impulses are sent down the length of the neuron and then are passed on to neighboring neurons, and that this connection of signals being passed from one neuron to another form pathways that send messages throughout your body. It's worth noting, though, that how this communication occurs is an electrochemical process. It's an electrical signal that goes down the neuron to the axon terminals, where it triggers the release of chemicals located at the end of the axon terminals and structures called terminal buttons. The chemicals released in this process are the neurotransmitters I mentioned previously. These neurotransmitters are released into a tiny gap between the axon terminals of one neuron and the dendrite of the neighboring neuron. This gap is known as the synapse, and they are present in all neurons in the nervous system. So neurons never actually really touch one another. What's really fascinating is that what neurotransmitters are released, when, and how much is released into the synapse is critical to how the nervous system functions. The way this works is that neurotransmitters are triggered by the electrical impulses hitting the terminal buttons. When the neurotransmitters are released, they get picked up by receptor sites located on the dendrite of a neighboring neuron on the opposite side of the synapse. The way in which these neurotransmitters interact with the receptor sites operates on what is known as a lock and key mechanism. So basically, if we have chemicals that have a structure that looks like this, then it will only activate a receptor site that has a similar shape. That way, the chemical fits into the receptor site like a key fitting into a lock. Other chemicals that have different shapes like these can't. Not all neurotransmitters in the synapse activate a receptor site. The ones that don't either diffuse into the nervous system, where they're later removed, or they get sucked back into the terminal buttons so that they can be used again later. This process of drawing back in neurotransmitters that were already released back into the terminal buttons is known as reuptake. What's really interesting is that humans have dozens of different neurotransmitters. Each of them is responsible for certain functions and are produced or stored in the nervous system. However, what's really fascinating and amazing is that medications, recreational drugs, and even routine substances we consume like caffeine impact our nervous system by interacting with these processes in some way. This can be done by increasing the number of neurotransmitters released or the sensitivity of the receptor sites. Substances that do this are known as agonists. Substances that decrease the number of neurotransmitters released or block the ability of the receptor sites are known as antagonists. There are also other substances called reuptake inhibitors that reduce the reuptake of neurotransmitters, which means they remain in the synapse and continue to activate the receptor sites. This means that more neurotransmitters aren't produced, but what is produced already is more effective. So its net effect is kind of similar to that of an agonist. Although there are dozens of different types of neurotransmitters, I wanted to take some time to really dive into some of the most important ones, at least the important ones for psychology. These neurotransmitters include dopamine, serotonin, epinephrine, endorphin, acetylcholine, GABA, and glutamate. I'm going to talk a little bit about each of these neurotransmitters and the role they play. However, keep in mind that most of these have multiple functions that overlap with other neurotransmitters. Let's start by talking about dopamine. Dopamine tends to be one of the most important neurotransmitters in psychology. It plays a role in a lot of different functions in your brain. For example, it deals with mood and sleep and learning. Beyond that, dopamine plays a critical role in perception and motivation also. Dopamine also plays a crucial role as your brain's feel-good neurotransmitter. Think of it like your brain releasing dopamine as a reward to motivate you to do something you need to do, like eat, drink, or reproduce. Humans are wired to engage in activities that release dopamine. This is how dopamine plays a role in mood and sleep also. Addictions, not just to substances, but also things like overeating and addictive behaviors, can also release dopamine for some people as well. Cocaine is a reuptake inhibitor of dopamine, which helps explain why it's so addictive. Although dopamine plays a role in mood and sleep, the neurotransmitter that is most associated with regulating these actions is serotonin. There's a theory that low serotonin levels in particular can lead to increased likelihood of depression. In fact, many medications for depression involve what is known as a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, or SSRI. These are classes of medication that inhibit the reuptake of serotonin, which, as I mentioned previously, has the effect of increasing the amount of usable neurotransmitter that's present. Many antidepressant medications are SSRIs, but not all of them. Of course, issues like depression can be far more complicated than just having a serotonin imbalance. Epinephrine, or norepinephrine, plays a critical role in your body's fight or flight response. It helps respond to threats by increasing arousal levels. This can lead to increased heart rate, breathing, blood pressure, and muscle tension. It tends to have a systemic effect that can lead to the release of many other neurotransmitters and hormones in order to prepare your body for a threatening situation. It's worth pointing out that epinephrine is both a hormone and a neurotransmitter, depending on where it's released. In fact, most epinephrine is actually released in the blood as a hormone. Sometimes when it's released as a hormone, you may see where epinephrine will be called adrenaline. However, this tends to be less common recently. Endorphin, or beta endorphin, plays a role in regulation of pain and pleasure. It serves almost like a counterbalance to epinephrine. When it's released, it can decrease anxiety and tension and increase overall well-being. Endorphin is released naturally in your brain and can also be released through engaging in certain activities. For example, sometimes I like to run for exercise. When I go for a run, I notice that it can actually be kind of difficult at first. I start running, I start noticing how uncomfortable I am. However, something kind of interesting starts to happen after maybe 15, 20 minutes or so. I start feeling better. I start feeling more comfortable. I start getting a little bit more relaxed. I get the runner high. This is triggered by your brain releasing beta endorphin in response to the stress you're placing on it from exercising. It can also happen while doing other things like meditation, yoga, and other activities. In fact, this is important to know because doing activities like this and helping your brain release this very important neurotransmitter is a great way to help manage stress. There are also less healthy ways to increase endorphins. Some opioid medications are agonists of endorphin. GABA, or gamma aminobutyric acid, is your brain's primary inhibitory neurotransmitter. What that means is that when GABA levels are high, they tend to lower a lot of the other neurotransmitters in your brain. So think of it almost like a seesaw effect. When one is high, the others are low, and vice versa. That's actually a really important regulatory role, too. A good way to think of it is imagine all the other neurotransmitters are kind of like kids in a kindergarten class. Imagine if someone really riled up the kids, gave them a whole bunch of sugar, and the kids are just running wild. They're running around screaming, going crazy. GABA would be like the teacher coming in and getting the kids to settle down. Alcohol is an agonist of GABA. So when you drink alcohol, you artificially elevate the amount of GABA in your brain, which then lowers the other neurotransmitters and leads to the effects that many people get from drinking. If GABA is like the teacher coming in to quiet down the kids, then you can think of glutamate as being like the person that was responsible for giving the kids the sugar and riling them up in the first place. Glutamate is the primary excitatory neurotransmitter. It can elevate other neurotransmitters, although this effect isn't as strong as the inhibitory effect that you get from GABA. Glutamate also plays a role in increasing things like learning and memory. Keep in mind that there are dozens of neurotransmitters and that very few things involving your brain are based on just one neurotransmitter. It isn't just the release of one neurotransmitter or the effect of one part of your brain. Rather, it's how all of these different parts come together, they work together, that makes everything possible. Thanks for watching, everybody.